rejoice and be glad in it. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this glorious day that you've given us. We thank you, Lord, for this first day of May, and this opportunity that has been given to us, Lord, to be able to worship you in spirit and in truth. We invoke now, Lord, your presence to be with us in the midst of this sacred celebration. Be it all that we do, and let it be, Lord, to your glory. This is our prayer in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Let the church say amen and amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Let's sing together with the congregation, the choir and the congregation. Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
we have a few announcements. First, we want to acknowledge if we have any guests, first time, second time, third time, guests, visitors in the house. You just raise your hand. We just want to acknowledge your presence. Let you know we're so thankful. We're so thankful. Amen. Glad that you're worshiping with us. Thank you for those who worship with us online as well. A couple announcements. The Baptist General Convention, the annual session is coming up, and I believe Sister Alexis Miles is ready to offer an announcement regarding that. Okay, that's all right. We'll move down to Women's Day. We'll come back to Alexis. Women's Day. Women's Day, we're trying to get back to a sense of normalcy on our calendar. Women's Day will be observed the third Sunday in May. Again this year, Dr. Kimberly Clark will be the guest preacher. I'm saying Dr. Kimberly Clark because she just defended her dissertation. She finished. She's graduating with a doctorate. So Dr. Kimberly Clark, friend of the church. As in the past, you know, we normally ask the women to give a special offer on Women's Day. This year, we are asking $50, at least $50 offer, if you're able to do that. And of course, brothers, we can match that. But we're asking all the sisters to give at least a $50 special offer for Women's Day. Nurses' Appreciation. We are so exceedingly grateful for our nurses and the work that they do here in the church, and the work they do on the job. We're so grateful for that, and we want to acknowledge them. And so we're going to ask if they can come forward. Sister Burma Bell. Where's Burma? All right. Brother Calvin Bell, if you can come forward. Sister Deanna Percy. Amen. And look, what better person to be able to say a few words than Dr. Deacon Andy Williams.
Good morning, everyone. Nurses, would you please stand, come into the very front of the church. In front of the sacred table. So, most of you think that if you got good medical care, that it was your doctor, that it was responsible. I'm here to let you know that medical care today is provided by a team based on a team concept. And I can tell you that the foundation of that team is the nurse. So whether you're in the office, in the hospital, in the operating room, in rehab, if you got excellent care, it's because you had an excellent nurse. Nurses are advocates for patients. They are trustworthy. They are committed to a standard. And you know, as you walk into this church, you may try to walk in without a mask, or try to walk in without getting your temperature checked, or try to walk in without completing that screening form. But you won't get very far. And so it is a privilege and an honor for me to acknowledge that our nurses, not just the ones who stand in the front, but I see our other two nurses, forgive me, Michelle and Pamela. Forgive me for not acknowledging you as well, but all of our nurses in our congregation are to be praised for their professionalism, for their excellent work, and for their commitment to human service. It is because of them that I stand here and that I have been privileged to be acknowledged over the years. When I was a student, a medical student, and a student physician, It was a nurse who taught me how to gown and glove to go into the operating room. And she would say, I'm going to teach you right. And she did. So acknowledge our nurses, please, for that wonderful work that they do, for the commitment.
Michelle, we also have something coming for you. Excuse us for not getting that together. All right. Sister Verm, I know that you had shared with us that we understand it's not just the nurses that are part of the health ministry, that it's another team of folk and volunteers who assist. And so there's some other presentation that you would like to make.
Family. We have some other presentations for people who have helped us through this pandemic. There's no way we could have done everything we do for you alone. So we have help, and I'd like to call those who have helped us and recognize them now. Pamela Journal. Mrs. Jacqueline Johnson. Mrs. Emily Land. Is Jackie Evans here today? Boy. Dr. Annie. And only one of our deputies is here today, our security guards, is Master Deputy Robin Parker. And hopefully I didn't omit anybody, but thank you all for being so. We appreciate you.
Thank you so much. Again, we thank you for your service, your faithfulness, your dedication, and your keeping us healthy. We appreciate it.
Good morning, everyone. I am before you this morning to give you an announcement about Baptist General Convention. We have upcoming in June the annual session. The annual session that we all remember from days past, the mega retreat, the one, the thing. I'm hyping this up as best I can. Can't miss it, you don't want to miss it. It is this coming June, and it will be in Richmond this year. The dates are June 26th through 29th. It will be a hybrid celebration, meaning that there will be in-person activities. It will be a full conference, and there will also be virtual opportunities to participate. Virtual components are still being developed, and you will have opportunities to participate from your home or from regional access centers. And I'm excited to be able to bring you more information about that as it comes. But please keep that in mind. It will be again in Richmond, June 26th through
Please look forward to it. A lot of work is going into it. It's a wonderful opportunity to travel, wonderful opportunity to fellowship, and to learn and be strengthened. In addition, we have on June 4th a virtual conference for children, youth, and workers. Again, that is June 4th, a completely virtual conference for children, youth, and youth workers. This is totally free. The registration for that event is already up. It is on Eventbrite, so you can search for it. You can also go to the Baptist General Convention of Virginia's website and access it there. If you have any questions about these events that are upcoming, I will be up here again and again to remind you about it. But in the interim, please feel free to contact me. If you don't already have my information, please call the church office and we'll put you in touch. Thank you so much.
Good morning, Miss Reed. Our Old Testament scripture this morning will be Psalms 30. Psalms 30. I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord my God, I called to you for help, and you healed me. You, Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing your praises to the Lord, you His faithful people. Praise His holy name, for His anger lasts only in a moment, but His favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may endure for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. When I felt so pure, I said, I would never be shaken. Lord, when you favored me, you made my mighty mountains stand firm. But when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, Lord, I called. To the Lord, I cried for mercy. What is gained if I am silenced, if I go down into the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, Lord, and be merciful to me. Lord, be my help. You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing in praise and be not silent. Lord my God, I will praise you forever. Weeping may endure for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Amen. Amen.
Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on
the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. The four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshiped. Amen.
Let me say, when you acknowledge folk in the church, invariably you're going to forget somebody. And in a church like Queen Street, a church with a big heart, you've got a whole lot of folk who are crossing over in responsibilities and serving. And so, Brother Cliff Rice, we've got to acknowledge your presence also, assisting in health ministry. And so many others. We apologize if we've left off anyone. But we want you to know that we're going to get it right. But we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Amen. Yeah, we don't get into the church without Cliff Rice. Amen. So he's another one who keeps us safe. All right. Amen. Look, it's prayer time. And this is that opportunity that we have to come together as a church family, figuratively just touching and agreeing as we carry our concerns to the Lord. What a privilege and joy it is that we're able to do this even throughout the weekday. In the morning and in the evening, we gather together for prayer. But we're also able to do it Sunday morning. And there's something special about that. So we're going to ask the elder to lead us this morning to God's throne of grace.
Let us bow and pray, everyone. Almighty God, it is once again that you have blessed us to assemble ourselves in this holy place. One more time. And we truly thank you. You woke us up this morning. You allowed us to see the beauty of this Christian Sabbath day and all the blessings that you sent with it. And with reasonable portions of health and all the necessities of life. Thank you. So we bow ourselves before you, your holy presence, this morning with contrite heart, and worship you in spirit and in truth, lifting up your name with the highest praises for who you are and what you mean in our lives daily. Your everlasting and your redeeming love, your unmerited mercy, your unlimited grace, your great faithfulness toward us, your holy word of promises, that whatsoever we ask for in prayer, believing, you would grant it to us. Thank you, Lord. You are truly our waymaker, Lord, our burden bearer, our miracle worker. Lord, you are our everything. You brought us through ups and downs, trials and tribulations. And through it all, you've been right there with us. And you made ways out of nowhere. So now, Lord, we come again to participate in this memorial meal. Help us to examine ourselves and come with pure hearts, clean minds, and clear conscience, acknowledging our sin, our shortcomings, our unworthiness, and forgiving those who have wronged us or trespassed against us, in accordance with the 18th chapter of Matthew. So we do not eat nor drink damnation to ourselves, not discerning the Lord's body. Lord, let us never forget the charge we have to keep to each other and the God we have to glorify. We pray, Lord, for a closer walk with you daily so that the world can see you in us. We pray, Lord, for a special anointment for the church membership, for strengthen them in mind, body, and spirit. We pray, Lord, for our leadership. Strengthen him, O Lord, with knowledge, vision, and wisdom. We pray for our youth, Lord. Help them to overcome fool's hell quickly in this life, that they would have a long and prosperous life and be the continuity of our church. We pray for the missions and the ministries of our church, that they would be a source of hope for the hopeless, strength for the weak, a source of love for the unloved, a beacon of light in this dark world. We pray that this worship experience would be a source of energy for the servant leaders within the congregation, and that they would not be ashamed to proclaim your word and your work, and evangelize your saving grace and overcoming power. We pray, Lord, for our families, our friends, and our acquaintances. We ask your continued guidance, O Lord, your continued blessings, and your continued mercy, because mercy is sure to suit our case. Then we pray, Lord, for the less fortunate among us, those close to us, those far away from us, those are sick, shut in, prison-bound, jails, nursing homes, wherever they are, Lord, remind them that you are there with them, and that you're more than sufficient. And in your word, you say you would never leave nor forsake. We pray, Lord, at the end of this worship experience for the offering that we will receive. We pray that the giver would be blessed with a double portion of your blessings. And we pray that you would multiply its usefulness and make all of the church ends meet. These, Lord, our petitions for this day, our supplications, and our prayer in that mighty, that matchless, that miraculous name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Thank you.
God's word. She's going to be coming from the 24th chapter of Luke's gospel. I'm going to just lift up a portion of it, but she's coming from Luke's gospel, chapter 24. And I'm going to read verses 28 through 32. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" God's word for the people of God, all praises be to God.
By God's grace that we are learning from one another. It's
just purely God's grace. Purely God's grace. I pray that God will help me as he always does.
Thank you.
Thank him for being good to all of us and being good to you. And I certainly thank him for being good to me. You just don't know what happens. I want to do everything that God asks me to do, and I know I won't be alone speaking to him. But let's think about what a good friend he is. And it goes like this. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we Almighty God, stop a moment to say, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh in this place. We cannot move forward another minute without thanking you for already showing up. Have your way on this day. We pray for spiritual enlightenment. We pray for strength for everyone called by the name of Jesus. We thank you now. It is in the name of God we pray through your Son. Amen. I do believe everything happens the way God wants it to. I just looked at my book and I think it's a whole page missing, so I guess that's right. A whole page. Hear the Lord saying, I put it in you. You do what I ask you to do. I certainly do appreciate the reading of the scripture. I would encourage every one of us, at some point before this day is over, read that entire piece. You can stop at 35 or 36, but the walk on the Emmaus Road, read that entire piece. I do what the Lord say do and what pastors say do. And I've heard some people say, well, we don't know the story. So I don't have all that time to tell that story. But there's some great pieces in there. And in this gospel, according to Luke, we find that this writer, this physician, Luke, supplements the knowledge of believers' Christianity. And then he puts special emphasis on salvation, and especially on eternal life. And so we know that there's no human that we could ever think about in this world that compares to Jesus. So I found it a little difficult because I know me, and the intro is always my weakest part. So I found a little challenge there. We can't talk about anybody when we speak about Jesus. We can't compare ourselves. We can't compare our friends. We can't compare our parents. We can't compare our preachers, because there's no one like him. But in the Bible, they talk about men of God and that they are type of Christ. But in the flesh, in this world, I just want to bring a bit piece of how we felt when two-term former President Barack Obama won that race. We were excited. We were happy. Crowds came from place to place to see him. And by no means is he comparable to Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ was on the scene. And crowds came, and they showed their light to the Lord. But we know what happened. So Barack, he came on the scene with all this enthusiasm and all this excitement and hysteria and all the hype and all this feeling of well-being that took place across the United States of America. And perhaps we got caught up in it. We believed and rested in our own thought that, and our own prayers. I was saying, I prayed for this. Well, how many know sometimes you don't get what you pray for? You get what God wants you to have. How many times you know that God will say, wait, or he'll say, move forward, or he'll say at a later date? Well, we prayed, and we thought that this Afro-American man would do it better. Just like everyone else, he couldn't do it by himself. He came in chanting, yes, we can. And we just latched onto that, yes, we can. Yes, we can. He did a great job. And we're so grateful and blessed that he was there. He was well deserved to be there. But when he was ready to leave the office, we got a little bit sad. And when we woke up and found out what had happened after the election, after he left office, we were disappointed and sad. For a few days, I felt I was in mourning, but I knew he couldn't do it again. But we were sad and disappointed when all that massive change didn't overthrow the racial injustices that we still endure. When all that hype and hysteria didn't change policemen killing our black folks and any folks, when all that discord and separation bipartisan in the legal system, in the political system didn't happen, we know very well what he was able to do. But we followed him just like we wanted to say, Hosanna, blessed be the name of Barack. Didn't happen that way. Disappointment set in. They gave him the Nobel Peace Prize the first year he was in. The first year. But he deserved it. He worked hard. And I want you to know that when we think about this scripture that's in your hearing, I want you to know that Jesus is on the scene. And sometimes we get a little disappointed. But in the end, it always works in our favor. All things work together for good of them who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So I would submit to you today that Jesus reassures his disciples. And all we need to do for a title, have a little talk with Jesus. Just have a little talk with Jesus. Talk to everybody else, yeah. Continue to be sociable and continue to be loving and continue to be helping and compassionate, but have a little talk with Jesus.
Because he will reassure you. He says he will reassure his disciples that he is with them, that he is here, that he is alive today. I think some of us need that reassurance today. How can he do that? He'll show you in the scripture. He moved on a journey. And on that road, there were two men. Right there, right around 27, 28, 29. They were stuck, stood still. That's the first move in the scripture. And Jesus shows up. And what happens? He has a little talk with his boys. He has a little talk with Jesus. And Jesus said, what are you discussing? Stuck on a road, on a journey with Jesus. Didn't recognize him. Disappointed. It said they stood sadly looking. Stuck on a road. And Jesus shows up. And Jesus shows up. That's the first instant he challenges us when he came. What are you talking about? And they go, are you the only one in the Jerusalem city that does not know what's happened in the past few days? How dare you talk to my Savior that way? But that's okay, because that's what the Lord wants. He comes to you the way you are. He comes to you how you are. He meets you on your road. He meets me on my road. He meets you at the point of your need. And he said, well, what happened? And the two were parenthetically saying, well, you know, they took this prophet who prophesied and did great miracles, even in the presence of God. But they sent him to the cross, and the word crucified means they killed him. But how many know that they didn't kill him? He gave, doing his work on the road. He had given his life. So they were stuck. And he listened to them talk. And that's a great thing about a great leader. He listened to them speak about how they tortured him, treated him. The chief priests, the leaders, they treated him poorly, didn't believe him. And on top of that, these two said, besides all that, this was their concern. Sometimes we have the wrong concern. On top of all that, the women came to tell us, didn't even say it right, that women came to tell us that they didn't see him there. That's not what they said. They didn't want the women to do their job. Women. On top of that, it's bad enough he's not there. It's bad enough I'm disappointed. It's bad enough I'm on the side of the road stuck, expecting him to set up the kingdom of Israel. But it didn't happen. Hallelujah. But the women came back to tell us that he wasn't there. Well, some of us men, we went down here. Some of the men that's with us, we went, we didn't see anything. We didn't see anything. But the Lord listened and he challenged them. The first sense of Jesus challenged you because of your slow heart of disbelief. Weak belief. Fragile belief. But belief. That's the good part. Jesus challenges their slow of heart belief with the word. And he didn't say, well, you know, you should remember this. Well, you know, I told you this. And he didn't do any of that. He knew that they were down in a slow state of sad thinking, verse 17. This is a slow, he identified, discerned that this is a slow, sad way of thinking that you're doing. Wait a moment. It's almost like he didn't say it, but just hold up a moment. Take a minute. Think about your thoughtless and your foolish belief. in the book. He said, "Oh, you fools," King James. In the New Revised, he said, "Oh, how foolish." In the Good News Translation, he said, "You foolish me." I didn't want to say it. I don't want to call anybody a fool. But how many know that the Lord takes the foolishness of the wise and uses it for the benefit of the saints? So he was, in a way, saying, you know, you have this slow to believe. Why are you so slow to believe what the prophets have written down through the years? Isaiah wrote it, that a king will come and the government will be on his shoulder. Psalm wrote that, blessed be the Messiah who sent one. Messiah means sent one. And Psalm, that's how he got through his. John wrote, there's one coming after me. I can't even tie his shoes. I'm not privileged. Then what Luke, one of the Gospels writer, wrote that I will wash your feet. If you want to be great, I must wash your feet. I come to serve. Why is it that we don't believe all the things that's written about God? He said, have faith, claim healing, speak to your parts, push forward, be positive. A doctor told me I had this, that, and the other, and it's going to be with me the rest of my life. I believe not. Follow your doctors. Why is it that you have this slow belief? You believe, and he's so concerned that he still loves us. And he still directs and guides us. And that's what he's doing on the road, having a little talk with his boys. It's necessary that the Messiah, he shared. Why wouldn't he have to suffer? It was necessary that he had to suffer all these things. And then, it's necessary that he suffer and struggle for you, for me. And then, hallelujah, he entered into his glory. He didn't do it for himself. He came from glory. He was flesh, wrapped in flesh, and came down through 42 generations just for us. He had to put his hand. He had to be put in the hands of the chief priest. He had to be handed over to leaders who didn't like him, to people who abused him. He had to be condemned to die, so he chose to give his life. He had to be killed, so he gave up the ghost. He had to be crucified. He had to be punished unrelentlessly and severely. And then, we will believe. And then we will believe. Move forward. You can't move forward when you're stuck in sadness. You can't move forward when you're stuck in disappointment. You can't move forward when the doctor gave you a bad report. You can't move forward. I wouldn't be here today if I really believed it. And every day I get up saying, I don't have no cancer 44 years. I wouldn't be here today if I didn't say, my arms are going to heal really well, even though they were broken. They heal. I wouldn't be here today if I listened to some of my doctors. When you know you're getting old and you gotta watch out for falls, don't talk to me. But talk to me. I hear you. I'm not disrespectful. I'll be like, oh, you okay? God, you hear that? God, you hear that? I'm not having that. I want to say one thing. I can't say it in mixed company, but they told me when you get 50, things happen to your female body. You know, dumb up. I said, it ain't happening to me. One day, that's all I give you. I never knew when I went through it. Hallelujah. Never knew. You know, your hair get thin and your body balloon. Not me. And I'm nobody special. I just believe God. It's coming. My day is coming. There will be a time when you will have to visit me on my bed of transition. And if you're around, please do it. If you're not, that's all right too. But I don't have to believe, because I'm not stuck on the road to Emmaus. I'm not stuck in what we thought. We thought he was going to set the kids. We thought he was going to reign. We thought that he was going to do this. No. He didn't come to make you great. He didn't come to make you rich. He didn't come to make you king. He didn't come to make you anything. He came to make you know that he's alive. Between resurrection and ascension, he is dealt with authority. I thank God that my husband came and said, you know what, you go do what you do best. I said, well, you coming one day. But I know that God cares for each and every one of us, that he meets you where you are. He challenges you to push your heart, to move forward in your belief, grow your belief, grow your walk, grow your thinking, grow all the things that he said in his word. Don't grow all the stuff that's going out in the street. Get educated, use it for the glory of God. Sing your songs to the glory of God. Shout if you must. My praise is a cry. I had to go out this ball. But God is good. And in the second instance, because God will meet you on your road if you have a little talk with Jesus. He'll reassure you that he wants to help you. He assures you that he wants to help. How does he do that? He, and we don't do this, we should. He spends time with you. He's following us around. He's standing at the door knocking. He's in your house before you walk out. He spends time. He came down the mass road where the two men was. Jesus knows that we could never ask too much of him. He knows that. He knows everything before we can even imagine what we have to ask. Sometimes we don't ask, and he will supply. But he will not give you something to hurt you. And when he was maneuvering, he's a good God. And he wants you to want it. And so he walked ahead of the boys. His intention was to go in the house with them anyway. They didn't know that, but he gradually moved in front of them. And they turned and said, come stay with us. Come in with us. They urged and pleaded him. And he turned right around and went in with them. This is in the resurrected body. Can't leave earth without cleaning up some stuff. Can't ascend without getting it straight with the boys, because they're going to be the ones that go forth and spread the gospel, spread like wildfire. But he urged them to come in. The boys urged Jesus Christ, the resurrected Christ, to come in. And this is the good part. Ask the Lord to spend time with us. Ask the Lord to tarry. And he will. But here's the good part. The good part is, he wants us to tarry with him. He wants us to tarry in his presence. Because in his presence, you will learn. Some people say, I don't understand the word, I don't understand the scriptures, I don't do King James, I don't do Amplified, I don't do New Revelation. Sit with the word. And let that word speak to you. And they still had not recognized this stranger. On the road, asking them about the scriptures, talking about all the prophets from the beginning to the end, right on to Malachi. And they still was unrecognized. You know, there's something called spiritual blindness. Sometimes we operate in it from time. We have ebbs and flow. Sometimes we hear it really quick, like, oh, God said this, and sometimes He's not speaking. Yes, he is. He's speaking. So when he got in, this is so good. I loved it. He took the bread. He went to the table. He took the bread, held it up, and he blessed it. If I saw that, I would have been walking with him to leaven. I think I know this man. He raised it. He blessed it. And he prayed. Now we know what happens on that communion. Because here we know what happens. We do the bread and we do the body, the wine. But right here is when he clicked. And the spiritual blindness fell off of his eyes. Because they had heard this, seen this, and done this. And before he went to the cross, that's what he did. And the way he expounded the word, that's what he did. And if you pay attention to him and not yourself, the blindness all over. And he took that bread, he raised, he blessed it, he prayed, and he broke it, and he gave. He still gave it. Don't run from the table. Come to the table. Jesus is at the table. Oh, I can't go because I, you know, I'll get damnation to myself. Come to the table. Do like the prodigal son. Go out, have him come in. Come to the table. He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you on the road. He's waiting for you. you at the table. Jesus is on the road, and he's at your table. Come to the table. Jesus did what he did with no hostility. Hallelujah. Jesus did what he did in the room with his disciples so they could see. Jesus broke the bread. Jesus held it up. Jesus talked to his learners and his followers. And that's what we call ourselves now, the disciples and the learners and the followers. Back then, they called them apostles and disciples. But we are still learners of the word of God. And he's certainly alive. He didn't want to say, well, you know, this is me, this is Jesus, I'm alive. You're supposed to know. All that he didn't say, you spent all this time with me. You read all these scriptures. And you're slow believing. And you got to ask. He's still standing at that parenthetical door knocking. Wanted to be asked to come in. So when they urged him, he went in, had supped. And they saw it before. They remembered. Allow Jesus to transform your belief and slow of heart belief to being quick and fast belief. Jesus said it, I believe it. If I just read it, that's impossible. I've never seen anybody get up from the dead, but I know that he stopped you. And I know people on hospital tables have checked out and saw the light. And came back. He wasn't even the first one of the dead. They say, was he? He demonstrated that with Lazarus. Jesus transforms you, meets you where you are, and he increases your belief, and he will come and be with you. He did promise, I'll be with you always, even to the end of the earth. Third and final, Jesus allowed their eyes to become open. Don't you want your eyes open today? Here's what he says to us about that. Listen to him. He's saying, listen to me. And I had to cross my page. Listen! How do we listen to the written word of God? You spend time. You sit over it. You say, what does that mean, God? And you pray, what does that mean? Teach me what I need to know. Just like I said, Lord, show me my dress. Show me my, how do you, God? Keep my thoughts right. Have to use God. If you do it for everything else, hallelujah, do it for the word of God. And I guarantee you, nobody had to cipher and tell you what it means. You can come with your own. And then you'll join in with a Bible study or a preachman and be able to say amen and agree. Everybody got their opinion. Everybody's destiny is different. Everybody's journey is difficult and different. But our end means is the same. Our end is the same, Barack Obama. Paraphrase. That's what he said. We're all different. And that's what Jesus meant. And so he came in. And he wasn't very talkative. And he would talk the scriptures. They listened. He broke the bread. They saw it. And once that happened, the shackles fell off his eyes. And he was able to move forward. He wasn't stuck. They were stuck. But he was able to vanish from them. He was able to keep on moving in the spirit because he's on assignment. They wanted to go. Once they get that, once you see Jesus, you're never the same. Once you experience it, no one's ever seen the face of the Lord. But once you experience an encounter with God, you know I'm not the same. You want to jump up and run and tell somebody. And you're going to keep telling. All last week, I said, Lord, I pray. I've been out to evangelize and share, but I've been doing it in my neighborhood, and I went out one day. You don't care, black, white, lady named Linda, give me last name B. She cried so much, and I'm like, talking to her. Carrying on in the store, finally just touched my heart. And I went over and put my arm around her. And she kept telling me this is wrong and that's wrong and my daughter this and my house this and my car that and my husband that. I said, you need Jesus. I said, where's your church? You need to read this. And I started writing. I said, because he'll change all of this. Ask him. No, next time we pray, the whole rest of the whole story just stopped. When the dead in Christ shall rise, we who remain be caught up in the sky. Come on, keep preaching. And he'll welcome us. I know it may be fearful. I might be the first one being scared. I recognized as soon as I saw her. And then I talked to her mom, and it was heartbreaking because she wasn't giving her no time. I said, that child needs you. At 3, I said, y'all need Jesus. And I'm living this life just to live again, not to stack up my riches on earth. I'm living this life, and I know that when he's coming, he'll come like a thief in the night, and he'll take us home one day. And in the meantime, do what the Lord does. In the meantime, help somebody. In the meantime, encourage somebody. In the meantime, be kind and nice to somebody. I've had a lot of people to not be kind to me. But I was so wrapped up in the Lord that I didn't even recognize they were not kind. I thank him for it. And this is your day to say that he's still living. And he went away to prepare a place for you. And one day, he's going to call us there. And why wouldn't we believe the scriptures? Because I don't want to think of no other way to live this life. And when I exit this life and transition this life, I want to be in the presence of the Lord. I can only imagine what it would be like when I walk by his side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face, Lord, is before me. Will I be surrounded by your glory? What will my heart feel? Or when all will I see you and stand there and be still? Will I? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to sing at all? I can only
burned within. As she shared God's word, thank God for you. We thank God for the messenger and for the message. The gospel has gone forth. We need to extend the invitation. There may be someone here today. Perhaps you do not yet know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. We want to extend that invitation to you. Is there one? If you already know the Lord, but you're looking for a church home, we'd like to extend that invitation to you also, to come by Christian Experience, to come as a watch care disciple. Is there one? Is there one? You may be seated. Broken for us. Let us commune together. Let us pray. Amen. In like manner also he took up the drink, and he said that it represented his blood, which was shed for the remission of our sins. And as often as we commune, we do so in remembrance of him. Let us commune together. Almighty God, we thank you, Lord, for your loving grace. We're grateful, God, for your love that is from everlasting to everlasting. We're grateful for this opportunity to be able to share together in this memorial meal. We thank you, Lord, for the manifestation of your love as it is demonstrated over and over, again and again. We are inspired by your word, Lord, that declares to us that you have purpose in our lives, that which is good and that which is prosperous. It is not your desire to hurt or to harm. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace.